We'll be reading from the second book of Timothy, second chapter, seventh verse. Reflect upon what I am saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all this.
God knows that even though we have committed our lives is going to create hardships on those trying to live spiritually. But we never have to stand alone if we give our all to God. We never have to try to do it all by ourselves. Friends, the world beats against us every day. And the only strength we have that can conquer the world is from God. And just so you know, you never have to stand alone physically either. By the grace of God, you've been given a family. Look around. This is your family. You've been made part of the family of God. Who will stand with you? But I'm going to tell you, in order for that to be effective, we have to swallow our pride. Sometimes we are going to struggle. And sometimes we need our brothers and sisters there, but if we don't tell them, we don't ask them, then how do they know to stand with us? How do they know what we're going up against? I don't believe that our fear of standing for the truth comes from a fear of losing, but from a fear of losing love and respect of people around us. I don't believe that our fear of standing for the truth keeps us from serving God, that we fear that someday it may cost us relationships. Well, probably will. God tells us in His Word that it will. But that's nothing to fear. Because when you stand for the truth, your brother will stand behind you. God will stand with you. See, in the strength that we receive, we can pass on. Because we can pass our ability, we can pass our knowledge to those around us. Paul tells Timothy in verse 2, "And the things you have heard from me, say in the presence of many witnesses, and trust to reliable men who will also be qualified to teach others." See, as we grow in faith and our spirit becomes stronger, when we develop that strong faith we desire to have in God, we can show that to others, we can teach it to others. Now, we can't make others do it, but we can pass it on. You can't ever make anybody use a talent. But if we demonstrate in our lives that we trust God beyond a shadow of a doubt, believe me, it's going to affect those around us, especially your brothers and sisters. You know, giving our all helps us to understand that teaching is not an option. We may not stand in front of a class, but our influence is going to teach everyone within whom we come in contact. People are going to see that we are with God, and He is with us. Paul here is instructing Timothy to teach others to be teachers. And when we give our entire life to God, teaching is easy. It's easy. Because it's what we do. We set an example. We live for God. We let our light shine. And people see that. People imitate that. You think about this. Why do parents try to limit, I guess, for lack of a better term, who influences their children? I mean, you've seen children imitate things they've seen on television, right? or imitate things they've seen other people do. It was learned. They were taught. So when we put ourselves in a position where we're serving God, we're teaching others. By our life, by the things that we do. Everything we need is in the Word of God. And His strength is in you. Look at Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. One of my favorite verses. Now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us. Our minds can't even think of something God cannot do. We can't even begin to imagine something that God can't accomplish. It's beyond our comprehension. And we can accomplish things from what Paul says here to the Ephesians according to His power that is at work in you. So we have this great power at our disposal because it's the power of God who can do anything that we can't even comprehend all we can do. He can do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine. Think about what that means. I mean, have we ever thought of asking somebody for something and saying, man, they probably couldn't do it? Never had that problem with God. I mean, and we do sometimes, and I know Christians who fail in their prayers because they think, well, God's not worried about that. God's not concerned about that. So I won't even ask him. What is it that God cannot do? Nothing. God can do anything. So giving God our all allows us to endure hardships. It allows us to be strong. Even though it may seem extreme, but it allows us to be strong. Endure hardships with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Being a Christian does not take away the problems. Does not necessarily make life easier. It gives us strength. Gives us power. But until we make a conscious decision from I want to serve God to I will serve God, hardship walks and draws us away from God, drives a wedge between us. And that's true in anything we do. Until we make the decision from I want to until I will, until we make that commitment, till we decide this is the way it's going to be. Maybe there's been something in your life that you can think back and think, I really want to do this. I've heard people say, I really want to go back to school. Well, what stops you? And we can usually come up with all kinds of excuses. Well, until you decide, I will go back to school, it's probably not going to happen. We have to make that commitment. See, we see this in Peter. He made his decision between the trials of Jesus and the day of Pentecost. I mean, when Jesus called Jesus? I think he showed me. He wanted to serve. But when a roadblock came up, was he willing to do whatever it took to get over it? No, he turned and ran from it. He turned and went the other way. But then on the day of Pentecost, what did he do? He stood up and he preached a convicting sermon. Because he decided, I do want to serve. I do want to be who I'm called to be. So we need to know that through God's strength, we can overcome it. Because his grace is always with us. You know, Paul, in speaking of the hardship they faced in Asia, in 2 Corinthians 1:9, he says, "But this happened that we may not rely on ourselves, but on God." And sometimes that's a hard lesson to learn because we like to be in charge. We like to know what's going on. And Paul said, "I didn't know what was going on. We was dealing with all this stuff. We just had to rely on God." I mean, think about Paul and Silas and Philippi in jail because, well, they didn't write, they cast an evil spirit out of a young girl that's preaching the gospel. And here they are put in prison, and what are they doing? Praying and singing praises to God. They were relying on him. They learned what it was. Sometimes hardships are put there so that we will understand and know what it means to rely on God, to get rid of that attitude. I can do this myself because we can. Secondly, giving God my all means living differently from the world. Think about that now. Living differently from the world. What this means is that our focus is different. We're going to live like other people. We are part of this physical world and we have to deal with the physical part. I mean, we don't have to be completely different from the world. We just have to focus differently. Look at what Paul says to Timothy here. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs and wants to please his commanding officer. The things that distract the world are most important to the world are different than us. I mean, they should be. I mean, sometimes we get distracted by things of the world, by those shiny things that draw our attention away. But we have to decide that God is most important to me, period. It doesn't matter what comes up. God is first, period. God is first. But God what? No, God is first. See, if I'm going to commit to him, if I'm going to give him my all, he is first. The soldier has a responsibility to his commanding officer. A Christian's responsibility is to God. Does he call us to do anything that's impossible? No. Does he call us to do things that could be uncomfortable? Oh, yeah. But he gives us the strength. I want you to pay close attention here to Paul's analogy in 2 Timothy 2:5. Similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive the victor's crown unless he competes according to the rules. Now, I know in today's modern world, we have a lot of cheaters at course laid out. And if you vary from that course in the race, you can't win. You can't break the rules. See, we can't change the rules. We can't modify them for our benefit. God made the rules, and they're His. And He didn't make them to burden us or to hinder us. He made them to improve us, to keep us whole, to keep us pure, to better ourselves. Have you ever said, God won't mind if I, and you can fill in the blank, or God will understand that if I did just this one time? Yeah, God understands. Because He's an understanding God. He's a loving God. He's a caring God. Does that mean that it doesn't hurt Him? No. And God says, when you're ready to come back, I'm ready to wait. Because God knows no matter how much we decide to put something in front of Him, how much it hurts Him, it's going to hurt us more in the long run. It's going to be more damaging to us. Think the prodigal son. He thought getting his part of the inheritance and going off to live the life he wanted, that's what it was all about. But it wasn't long until he was feeding unclean animals and wanting to eat what they were eating. It wasn't long at all. And the Father looked for him every day. So if we're going to commit to God, our life must be new in Christ. Look at what Paul says in Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. So when we become a Christian and we tell God we want forgiveness of our sins, we want to make Jesus Lord and Master of our life, it's not about living the same old life in a new setting. It's about having a new life. Having a new life. It means that we no longer focus on self, but on God. On others. It means that I ask myself the question, what does God desire for me? What does He desire of me? Then I follow that desire regardless. Because I'm giving Him my all, placing all my faith in Him, allowing Him to lead me. But if we are thinking worldly, it won't allow us to do that. Because we think, instead of thinking what God wants, we start thinking what we want. What do people around me want? How can I please those close to me? So we have to change our way of thinking. Paul goes on and reminds us that the hard worker should be the first to be rewarded. There is a certain reward for giving God's wrong. 2 Timothy 2:6 says the hardworking farmer should be the first to receive a share of the crops. Friends, there are definite blessings in serving God. Definite blessings in serving God. Now we know the ultimate blessing, of course, is eternal life, being in heaven with Him, and that's great, and that's a great goal. Friends, they're blessing in this life as well. blessings we have today for serving God. I mean, I think obviously here God is promising blessings of multiple kinds. If we commit completely to God, we'll receive blessings beyond what we've ever imagined. I want you to think about that. I think most of us, if we was answering honestly, if someone asked, have you been blessed in your life, we would all say, yes. I think we would. But I think if we were able to ask God, have you blessed me with every blessing I could possibly have, I think he would also say, no. Because I think there's so much more that we could have if we could just commit to him. If we would just open up our lives to him. I mean, think about Paul, if you will, in his life. I don't think there's anybody in this room that says, I want to trade places with him. I mean, we don't want to go through what he went through, do we? But one of the great blessings that he had, even going through the things that he went through, was the attitude of, you know what, I'm doing this for God, so it doesn't matter. That everything that I'm going through here doesn't amount to anything compared to what I'm going to get eventually. My service to God doesn't even begin to compare the reward I will receive for this service. There's a story that's told, an old preacher story, of a man that goes to heaven and he's walking through this warehouse with Jesus. And Jesus says, this is where we keep the blessings. And he's looking around at small boxes and big boxes and medium-sized boxes. And he finally comes in front of a bin that has his name on it. And he stops. And he looks. And he sees several boxes still there. And so he turns to Jesus and he says, why are there still boxes in my bin? I'm here. I've got the ultimate blessing. And Jesus said, those are the blessings you wouldn't receive. Those are the ones we couldn't give you while you were on earth. Because you were thinking inwardly. You weren't committed. I mean, we think about this, we hear athletes talk about giving 110%, leaving it all on the field. Can you imagine getting to heaven and being told, sorry, there's still so much more you can have? You see, there's so much to absorb and to learn from these six verses in 2 Timothy. There's just a lot of information here. I want you to look at verse 7. Reflect on what I'm saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all of this. Reflect means to study and to meditate on. God wants us to understand why we should give him our. It's not because he just wants to be in charge. It's not because he has this power trip going. It's because he loves us beyond what we can even begin to think of. He created us in his image and he sent Jesus to die for us. But notice here that Paul says, when you reflect on this, the Lord is going to you will get wisdom. Which just is another reminder that God always knows exactly what we need. So why wouldn't we give our all to him? Why wouldn't we look back? Because he knows exactly what we need. See, giving God our all will bless us more than we can even imagine. And through His strength, we can overcome anything. And so we need to focus on serving God and not be distracted. That's what God told Joshua. Pretty much said, remember the words of the law. Don't vary from it. Don't be distracted by the things that's going to come up in life. Focus on it. You see, God doesn't want the blind loyalty. He wants unshakable faith. Faith that we can put in Him and know that it's in the best possible place. He wants a faith that will allow us to commit completely and fully to Him all the time. And the reward for what we see, we can't even begin to imagine how wonderful life would be. But we have to make that commitment. We have to move from I want to I will. If you're here today and you've made the statement in times past, I want to be forgiven of my sins, I want you today to say, I will be forgiven of my sins. You have the opportunity to be immersed in the water of baptism.